And just a few other things as we get started this morning, announcements for you. You'll notice them in your bulletin, but I just want to highlight them. One is this coming Saturday is our Awana Grand Prix. It's a great opportunity for fellowship. How many of you have ever made a car for the Awana Grand Prix? Raise your hand. Okay, a good number in our body. Any age, any person, doesn't matter if you're part of Awana or not, you can make a car. So buy a car today before you leave if you want. Paint it, decorate it, prepare it, and come race it on Saturday for a great time of fellowship. Speaking of fellowship, next Sunday is the fifth Sunday of the month. And on every fifth Sunday here at Renton Bible Church, we celebrate with a potluck. And so come next Sunday, bring something. The instructions are there in your bulletin. Bring something to share and enjoy a time of fellowship together as a body. It's good to take advantage of opportunities for fellowship, to remember that we're not just here to fulfill a religious obligation. We gather together as the family of God. And so it's good to know your family. So come and enjoy this time of fellowship together with family. And speaking of getting to know your family, there is also a sign up out in the foyer right now for our enfolding meals. And the enfolding meals are very simple. You sign up. We get together just for one meal. Groups of in our church will be divvied up, and they'll get together in different homes. It's just one-time commitment, but we pair together people who are longer-term members of our body with newer folks in our body, and the longer-term members host or co-host meals, and they're paired up with those who are newer, and we just have a time of fellowship in a home. And so if you haven't done that yet, I encourage you. The sign-up is out in the foyer. I was contemplating a familiar quote this week. Experience is the best teacher. Are you familiar with that one? And I came across this picture. Experience is the best teacher. The first thing that I thought of when I saw this picture was a friend named Rich. Some of you have heard Deb and I talk about Rich. More than 20 years ago now, we got a phone call from Rich's mother. Deb and Rich had attended the same Christian high school down in San Diego, but it just so happens that at the time, both of them had relocated to Oregon. However, the phone call was not simply a social call. It was the delivery of some very bad news. Rich had been in a terrible skiing accident and was in a coma in the brain injury unit in a hospital in Bend, Oregon. It would seem that he had skied over a drop-off and fell 20 feet, landing on the back of his head against a tree. When we went to see him, he looked horrible. He was, of course, in a coma, so he could not speak, but there was a shunt coming out of his head, and he just looked terrible. He would remain in a coma for more than 9 months, which is a long time to be in a coma. He would remain in a hospital for more than a year, and it would be well over, a number of years before he would learn to even crawl again. He had to start, when you're in a coma like that, you have to start from the very beginning, and it's a lot of work. It's hard to believe that our friend Rich, though he was in his early 20s when this accident occurred, has now spent almost half of his life post-accident. In some ways, Rich's story is that of a modern-day Job, for he's undergone intense suffering, but has never forsaken his faith in God. In fact, Rich and I have had many conversations about the book of James. That's his favorite book, which you may recall begins with, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because the testing of your faith develops perseverance." And certainly we've seen in Rich a great perseverance in his faith. But this event has also served to make me more cautious and aware of just how easily a fun day on the slopes or in the mountains or in any place, really, can actually turn tragic. The truth is, the older we get, the more life we experience, the more cautious we become. Have you noticed that? The older you get, the more careful you are. And it's because of experience. And it isn't necessarily something as dramatic as downhill skiing. It's playing flag football at our annual turkey bowl. It's climbing tall ladders or working on top of a roof. It's backing out of a parking spot or making a sharp turn or changing lanes on the freeway. Life experience teaches us to be more cautious, more tentative. Once bitten, twice shy. When I was younger, I didn't understand this kind of caution in my elders. But things like broken thumbs and fractured elbows and separated shoulders and injured backs have taught me to be more cautious. Now, many of us would extol the virtues of caution. However, let me ask you this question. Is caution ever bad? Think about that for a moment. Is there such a thing as being too cautious? I actually came up with a handful of examples when I was contemplating that question. For example, sometimes a less experienced driver can actually cause an accident by being unable to make a decision. An emergency worker, like a firefighter or a police officer, might be limited in the ability to do their job because of too much caution. You don't want an overly cautious firefighter at your house when your house is on fire. But it isn't just with regards to life-threatening situations. Too much caution in relationships can keep us from giving or receiving love. And I've seen this. Have you seen this? People who have gone through difficulties in relationships and they stay back. They keep at a distance. Too much caution in jobs can keep us from making a needed job change. Too much caution in life can keep us from meaningful experiences. I have to say, I was a wee bit trepidatious about hiking the Grand Canyon. It wasn't the going down that was so concerning to me. It was the coming back up that I was a little concerned if I could make it. But I am so grateful that I did. Thank you, Rick, for helping me get beyond my trepidation so that I could experience the magnificent display of the majesty of our God. However, I do not think there is any area where being overly cautious has more dire effects than when it comes to the Christian life. As Christians, we are called to continue Christ's mission in the world, but at times, I think too much caution keeps us from fulfilling that commission. It's neglecting to help someone in need because of the risk of your time, your energy, your person. It's skimping in your offerings for fear of decreasing your discretionary budget. It's an unwillingness to commit to regular ministry for fear that it might take away from your free time or your other obligations. It's refusing to participate in a small group or life on life group or men's breakfast or ladies' study or even coming to a fifth Sunday fellowship for fear of heightened expectations. It's not taking advantage of the opportunity to share the reason for your hope with a neighbor or family member or friend out of fear of rejection. Sometimes I think we can be a little bit too cautious when it comes to living for Jesus. When it comes to the things of God, we are called to live lives of boldness. This is the example we've seen in the Apostle Paul in his letter to the believers in Thessalonica, our current sermon series, Our Hope. Paul exhibits and calls believers not merely to boldness, but as we shall see today, to gospel boldness. He calls us to be fearless, unashamed, bold for the sake of the gospel. If you haven't already done so, I invite you to take your sermon outlines from your bulletins. If you didn't receive one of these, just raise your hand and Pernille will make sure that you get one. I also invite you to turn in your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. We're going to begin with the first 9 verses of 1 Thessalonians 2. Now, I get that this word here, gospel, can feel sometimes like a super religious word. But I want to remind you once again that the word gospel simply means good news. That's all it means. If you found out about a cure for a specific kind of cancer that someone you love was battling, you would want to share with them the good news, wouldn't you? That's what we're talking about when we talk about gospel. It's good news. If dear friends were struggling in their marriage and you had found a resource that really helped you in yours, you'd want to share the good news. That's all the gospel means. And in view of the never-ending news cycles filled with bad news, I feel like we could use a little more good news in our lives. Amen? But the reality is, sharing this good news requires boldness because this kind of good news doesn't always get a warm reception. Paul knew this. He knew this firsthand, as we see in the first few verses of 1 Thessalonians 2. You know, brothers, that our visit to you was not a failure. We had previously suffered and been insulted in Philippi, as you know, but with the help of our God, we dared to tell you his gospel in spite of strong opposition. We return once again to our map. And we see here on our map, Philippi, up here in the upper right-hand corner. Do you see that there, just below the Ignatian Way? A little further along, you see Thessalonica. And that's the church to whom Paul is writing this letter. But Paul makes a reference to the ministry in Philippi that took place just before he got to Thessalonica. And if you look in your Bibles, Acts 17 shows us Paul in Thessalonica. Acts 16 shows us Paul in Philippi and shows us exactly the kind of reception he got there, dragged into the marketplace, stripped, and beaten. I've put the reference in the For Further Study section at the bottom of your notes. I encourage you later on today or this week, take the opportunity to read that section in Acts 16. And so when Paul says in verse 2 that they had suffered and been insulted in Philippi, he means it. But here's the thing. If experience really is the best teacher, it would seem that Paul didn't learn his lesson. Do you notice that? He's just gotten through in Philippi, where they've been stripped and beaten, and he comes to Thessalonica. And what does he do? Well, a wise man would have kept his mouth shut. Right? I mean, just don't stir things up, Paul. You've just gotten through this horrible experience. You don't want to come and have the same thing happen to you in Thessalonica. But what does Paul actually do? He comes to Thessalonica, and he preaches the gospel. And of course, we know he ends up getting chased out of Thessalonica as well. But here's the thing. Paul did not learn his lesson. He did not become trepidatious. He did not become filled with tentativeness, caution. Instead, he said, you know what? No matter what happens to me, I have got to share this good news. I've got to do it. Nothing can hold me back. It's too important. What do we read was Paul's response after taking a beating in Philippi? Well, again, verse 2 tells us, we previously suffered and been insulted in Philippi, as you know, but with the help of our God, we dared to tell you his gospel in spite of strong opposition. We dared to preach the good news in spite of strong opposition. Do you see the word opposition at the end of verse 2? In Greek, it actually looks like this. Now, you may be thinking, Dan, I don't speak Greek. What meaning can this have for me? But actually, this is one of those words, and actually, there's a lot of correspondence between English and Greek. And you can kind of get what the word is here because there's an English word that's transliterated from this Greek word. The first letter looks like a what? Anyone? An A, right? How about the second letter? What does that look like? It looks like a Y. Okay, think of one other letter it might look like. It actually is a G. It has a G sound. A-G. Now, I won't forget the next two because they're foreign. The last one, what does that look like? an I, or actually a Y, either one. So AG and ends with I or Y. And I'll tell you that the W-looking letter is actually an omega, so it has an O sound, A-G-O. And the V actually is a nu, has an N sound, A-G-O-N-I or A-G-O-N-Y. Agony. We get our word agony directly from this word, which is translated in your passage as strong opposition. In other words, Paul is using this word that says, we really had a tough time. I mean, this was serious. It was agonizing. We were under attack. We faced unbelievable opposition. But we dared to share the gospel anyway. Why do you think Paul says this? Do you think it's to stroke his ego? Do you think he's like, look at us, we're so great. It was so hard, but we dared to do it. Do you think that's why Paul does it? No. I'll tell you why Paul does this. It's because Paul knows that the Thessalonian believers are also experiencing opposition. He knows that because he remembers the reception he got there. He knows that there are people who are not receptive to the gospel, in fact, who are oppositional to the gospel. And so Paul is setting an example for the believers in Thessalonica, saying, yeah, you may go through hard times, very difficult times, to live for the gospel, but so did we. And that's just the way it is. But you need to dare to speak the truth of the good news. Just as he and Timothy and Silas dared to share the gospel in the face of great persecution, so too his challenge for the Thessalonians is dare to share. Some of you may recognize this title, Dare to Share, because it's actually a program that was for youth. I don't know if it's still going. I know a number of years, our youth went to an event called Dare to Share. And it was a challenge to the youth to dare to share their faith. But believers, it's not just for youth. It's not just for kids. It's for all who have been touched by the gospel of Christ. Why? What would motivate me to dare to share in the face of strong opposition? The answer is found in verses 3 and 4. For the appeal we make does not spring from error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. On the contrary, we speak as men approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please men, but God who tests our hearts. So the short answer to the question why dare to share is simply to please God. But more specifically, Paul reveals what their motive was not. He says it was not from, first of all, error, second, selfishness, or third, trickery. You've undoubtedly encountered those who are motivated to share from error, haven't you? People who are motivated to share because they believe something that's not according to the Word of God, and certainly cults would fit into those parameters. You've probably had people show up on your doorstep preaching another gospel, motivated to share from error. You've undoubtedly also seen preachers on TV motivated to share from impure, selfish motives so they can drive fancy cars and buy fancy planes. And then there's trickery. One commentator says about trickery, the third accusation is that of using trickery. The word rendered to trick originally had reference to catching fish by means of a bait. Now, I'm familiar with that kind of trickery. Catching fish by means of a bait. When Greg and I fish for bass, we use fake plastic bait. In other words, we are doing our best to trick the fish to swallow the hook. It's a trick. Using bait for fish is just fine, but using bait with people is a no-go. Trickery, then, is less about motive and more about methods. It's an example I used last week of someone pretending to offer friendship but really just wanting to sell me Amway. Sharing Christ's love must never be bait and switch. It must be a relationship without a hook. Maybe the people we are seeking to love will never be receptive to the gospel, but we don't stop loving them. We must have nothing to do with bait and switch trickery. So Paul says, we share not from error, selfishness, or trickery, but as those approved, entrusted to please God. Approved here simply means that they are the real deal. How are they approved? Well, they have been through it, haven't they? They've demonstrated their authenticity, going through difficult trials, but staying true to the Lord. Entrusted indicates that they share because Jesus has called them to do so. Believers, we must exercise gospel boldness because Jesus is the one who commissioned us to go and make disciples. He's the one. And finally, the motive driving all of it is to please God. This isn't about winning converts to my religion. This is about doing the work of the King to draw people into relationship with the King to bring glory to the King. As Dylan sang, everybody's got to serve somebody. So who are you serving? Paul, Silas, and Timothy said, we are serving God. Their goal is to please Him. For that reason, Paul writes in verse 5, you know, we never used flattery, nor did we put on a mask to cover up greed. God is our witness. We were not looking for praise from men, not from you or anyone else. So what we see here is Paul's contrast of baloney versus bona fide. You know what baloney is, don't you? It's that kind of meat, right? I have a confession to make. But first I should ask this. Are there any bologna lovers out here? Does anyone just love bologna? I like it, man. Very good, Nehemiah. I will tell you this. Even as a kid, I never liked bologna. It's like the press board version of meat, right? It's all this stuff pressed together. I never cared for bologna. Maybe I'm a snob, but I'd rather eat meat that actually looks like it's meat. I want the real thing, bona fide. What is baloney when it comes to how you share the gospel? Well, first, it involves flattery. Revered theologian F.F. Bruce says about this, the flatterer is a stock character in the literature of ethics and manners, who habitually employs flattery to gain some advantage for himself. He trades on the fact that people naturally like to hear things which set them in a favorable light. Isn't that true? Everyone loves to hear you say things that make them look good. And by telling them such things, he expects to gain a following. That's what the flatterer does. It is easy for churches to get into the mode of telling people just what they want to hear. But the result is that you are forced to water down God's word, denying Scripture of its power to transform. Transformation doesn't come about by telling people only what they want to hear. Ask any physical trainer, and they will tell you the same thing. Paul also decries the baloney of greed and of praise from men. Much different than such baloney is bona fide gospel sharing. What does that look like? Well, it involves gentleness, selfless care, costly love. Look at the second half of verse 6. As apostles of Christ, we could have been a burden to you, but we were gentle among you like a mother caring for her little children. We loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well, because you had become so dear to us. Surely you remember, brothers, our toil and hardship. We worked night and day in order not to be a burden to you, burden to anyone, while we preached the gospel of God to you. Listen, it's easy to talk about love, but doing love, that is a whole other thing. In fact, I love this title. Ellie's been reading the book, Love Does. I love that book title, Love does. Because that's what we see in Scripture time and again. Love is an action. It's something you do. It's not just a state. It's hard because it requires gentleness, sometimes in the face of an ungracious or unreceptive spirit. The kind of love Paul talks about here, bona fide gospel sharing, requires selfless care. Caring for other people is messy. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Caring for other people is messy. I mean, it just is. When you get entangled with the lives of other people, you risk, which is why we're so trepidatious at times. And it's costly, both in time and in energy. Sharing the gospel requires an emotional investment. And it's investment that sometimes pays no dividends. You might face rejection. However, it has the possibility of a payoff that is out of this world. When you see someone truly embrace hope in Christ, experience genuine transformation in their lives, and find strength in Jesus that they never could have found in themselves, that makes it all worth it. If you have sought to live out the gospel boldly, I have no doubt that you've probably experienced the messiness of caring for other people. Sometimes they turn and attack. It can be really messy in this world. Deb and I were just talking about this. Sometimes you'll face repercussions in your workplace for being bold and sharing Jesus. Sometimes you'll face repercussions in your family or even in your neighborhood. But here's the thing. Whether they know it or not, the people of this world need good news. We need good news. And sure, there are going to be some who are going to be unreceptive. They may even reject you. And by the way, can I just make this statement? I'm not talking about rushing up to someone you've never met before and said, "You need to accept Jesus now," right? I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about building relationships with people. And I'll say it, I think, again in a few moments, but people do not care how much you know until they know how much you care. It's a relationship built on love and care. And that's what Paul demonstrates here. He says, "We were gentle with you. We were like a mother. We cared for you. We loved you." That's the example that he sets for us. But though sometimes it will meet with rejection, I will tell you this, and if you've experienced this, you know what I'm talking about. There is nothing sweeter than seeing someone whose lives have been transformed by the truth of the gospel. Someone who was hopeless, who finds real hope in Jesus. Someone whose lives were just at the bottom, who find real life in Jesus. And someone who had given up on love, who finally finds out that the God of love loves them. That makes it worth the risk that you take to share love in Christ. And so, self-giving love is costly. The word bona fide here simply means in good faith. We're talking about real, genuine, sincere. Real gospel ministry means sharing your life with others. Look at verse 8 again. "We loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well, because you had become so dear to us." One commentator refers to the love Paul describes here as a self-giving love. I don't usually read a lengthy quote from a commentary, but these thoughts on the love Paul describes in verse 8 are worth hearing. He says, "Many of us don't often experience self-giving love. Some of us have not even observed it in action. Why is this? Because ours is a self-centered age, and true love is sacrificial." As Bill Hybels observes, "Tell me how to show love without spending time, energy, or money, and I will gladly sign up. Tell me that love means sacrifice, however, and I become reluctant to commit myself. Apart from the self-centeredness characteristic of our fallen human nature, so overwhelming are the cultural messages to look out first and foremost for our own interests and to seek our own happiness first, that we are reluctant to commit to helping others without fully knowing the cost or limits in advance. The risk to our own interests, if we do otherwise, we have been persuaded, is simply too great. In an age so committed to self-interest, Paul's example of committed, costly love for others is pointedly countercultural. In deciding how to spend his time, he did not think first of his own needs or rights, but those of the Thessalonians. For their sake and because of his love for them, he was willing to endure toil and hardship, verse 9, and to share with them not only the gospel, but his life, verse 8. In doing this, he was, of course, simply following the model of Jesus, who put a priority on giving rather than getting, on serving rather than being served, on loving rather than being loved. The irony is this, that in giving of himself for the sake of others, Paul found happiness and satisfaction for himself. Indeed, if verse 8 is any indication, Paul seems a bit overwhelmed by the extent to which the relationship with the Thessalonians developed. In loving others, he seems to have received back more than he could have imagined. I think there are some great thoughts in that excerpt. We live in a culture that is all about self-interest. But the model we see in Scripture is that of self-giving. Self-giving is costly. But Jesus is the one who set the example. And Jesus is the one who has called each of us to live a life of love. Yet the reward is worth the cost, not just in eternity, but even in this life. Sure, at times our love will not be reciprocated. And it may even seem like it's in vain. But there are also times when this costly love will reap a beautiful, immeasurable reward in terms of its impact on those who receive it and those who give it. Which brings us to that very important question, so what? I offer you four simple answers to that question, so what? How to live boldly. First, we must prioritize the gospel. This may seem a little too obvious, but for most of us, sharing good news shows up on our list of priorities somewhere between scrubbing the toilet and washing the dog. Isn't that true? I mean, we just don't think about sharing good news, in part because of our fears, our trepidation. What will happen? I might get rejected. And honestly, I think part of it is, I know for me, is I'm just selfish. I have my own things I want to do. I don't want to get messed up with the entanglements that are involved. Think of what would happen to us. Our church wouldn't be here if Paul had said after he came to Christ, after he was blinded by the light and was baptized, if he said, you know, I'm just glad to be saved. I'm just going to go ahead and live my life. If he had said that and refused to go out sharing the gospel in the known world, where would we be? How about Jesus? What if he had said, you know, I don't think I really want to go down to earth. It's kind of messy down there. I prefer to rule on my throne. But instead he said, not only will I condescend by grace to become a man, but I will sacrifice myself, pay the ultimate sacrifice to reconcile man to God. Believers, we must learn to prioritize the gospel. And as with anything in our busy lives, sharing the gospel only happens if we make it happen. We've got to prioritize it. We've got to make it happen. Which brings us to our second aspect of how to live boldly. Act with integrity. This is also somewhat obvious, but if our faith isn't resulting in increasingly authentic Christian lives, see last week's sermon for that, then people won't be interested in our faith. What I'm saying is, first and foremost, before you talk to someone else, you yourself need to be following the Savior. Now, I'm not saying you need to go to Bible college or get a degree or you know, be able to answer so many percentage of the questions in Sunday school class. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying you need to be seeking Jesus. Are you seeking Jesus? Are you growing in your love relationship with Him? If you are, then you have the opportunity to share that with others. And so act with integrity means that you are authentically following Jesus. We're not talking about perfection, but we are talking about authenticity. If we are to engage in preaching the gospel to others, we must make sure that we are daily preaching the gospel to ourselves. And then in addition to that, it means that we share Jesus with people with right motives. That we're not doing it to get a notch in our belt or to try and make people think the way we think. We're not interested in those kind of converts. We share Jesus because we know that He's the source of life. And we do it with honesty and integrity. You'll notice we don't, at our church, do things. I remember when I was in Bible college, one of the tasks that I had to do is I had to go around and take surveys at people's houses about spiritual beliefs. But the survey on spiritual beliefs wasn't really actually about a survey, because I wasn't keeping a list so much of what people believed. It was a means for me to start talking to them about Jesus. Now, I always questioned that, because it felt like it was a little inauthentic, like I'm like bait and switch. Like, oh, I'm just here to take a survey. Oh, okay, I'll help out the community and give my responses to the survey, and then I actually start to talk about Jesus. I wonder about that. Make sure we act with integrity. It's not bait and switch. Don't invite your friends over to your house and say, hey, we're just going to have coffee, and then when you sit them down, you lock the door behind them and you start drilling them about Jesus. Act with integrity. And of course, that brings us to the third point, which is we need to learn to love sacrificially. You cannot get around this. To share good news with others, you need to be willing to give of yourself. And that's the example that Paul gave us here, right? He says, we didn't just bring you the gospel, we gave of ourselves to you. We poured our very lives into you out of love. And again, that's that old saying I just mentioned a few moments ago. People do not care how much you know until they know how much you care. Obviously, we all seek to love our kids, our spouses, our siblings, our parents. But outside of family, we must ask ourselves, are we loving, caring for, pouring our lives into others? Are there people outside of our family that we're pouring ourselves into, that we're willing to serve, even if it costs us something? That we're looking for opportunities just to show them Christ's love, even if it's in the simplest of acts. And finally, to exercise gospel boldness requires us to live deliberately. You can't get around this. Paul was driven by mission. Jesus was driven by mission. But the norm in our world, and too often in the church as well, are lives driven by self-interest. And I have to pause here and say, believers, I think it's just as true in the church as it is outside of the church. You know, there are many things about our culture that we have not bought, that we've said, no, we reject that. We reject the idea that life is meaningless, it's worthless, it can be just tossed aside. We reject that. We reject the way that women are treated in our culture when bodies are presented and treated just like meat. We reject that. We'll have nothing to do with pornography and those kinds of practices. There are certain things we reject, and we say we cannot have anything to do with that as followers of Jesus. But an area where I think we line up more with our culture than we really would like to think is when it comes to self-interest, living for self-interest. What are we living for, believers? What drives us? Is it the things we have? Is it fun? being entertained, recreation? What is it that drives us? Is it self-interest, or is it a selflessness, like the selflessness that we saw in Jesus, like the selflessness we see in Paul? That's what I loved about the responses we got to the four challenges in the Growing Together campaign. Do you remember those four challenges? Anyone tell me what those four challenges is? Just give me one of them. Anyone? Of the Growing Together campaign, what were the four challenges we had? I heard something. Invite was one of them, yes. What else? Serving. Thank you very much. Yes, commit to serve. Yes, yes. What next? Giving. Yep, and? Belong. Four great commitments. But I'll tell you the thing about those challenges. They all are costly. Right? To belong is costly. To give is costly. To serve is costly. To invite is costly. That's why we called them challenges, because they're challenging. But I'll tell you, those of you who turned in cards, I was amazed at the way people were willing to give up self-interest and jump in and make commitments. I mean, just some amazing things that we saw. All of them are difficult. All of them are inherently sacrificial, deliberate, bold, and gospel-focused. That doesn't mean that they're easy, but it means that they are challenges. And if you're like me, the invite challenge in particular has been maybe the most difficult of all four of them. It's important, but there are many obstacles to inviting people. Do you feel that? Maybe you think, well, I'm the only one. Everyone else, it's easy. I actually often talk about Jerry Larson, who was the teacher who came, and he actually presented a seminar on evangelism here at our church at least once, if not a couple times. Wonderful old preacher. Gregarious guy. Just the kind of guy you come into his presence, and he just has the warmest smile. He just invites you right in. You just feel engaged by him. So engaging. And I can imagine Jerry Larson, he was the one who discipled me. I can imagine him discipled me with regards to evangelism, I should say. And I can imagine him, you know, just talking with someone on the golf course or someone at the store. And for him, he's just so engaging. It's hard not to like him, and to have him share Jesus with you is just like, you know, it's like nothing. It's just he does it so with such ease. For most of the rest of us, it's hard. It's difficult to talk about Jesus with our friends, with our loved ones, our neighbors. And yet, it's so important. And it's never more important than now. We look at our world that is torn with strife and division, and people are looking for hope. Believers, we know what the hope is. But it takes boldness if we'd be willing to share it. And so here's the thing. I've recognized that we have this stress that we've created here. We know we're supposed to share. We know we need to share. And yet it's really difficult. And so the result is this. The invite challenge, a dialogue. We are hosting an event here at our church on the second Sunday in February, February 12th. It's going to go from 6 to 7:30. And the purpose of this event is for us to have a dialogue on how you share good news in the culture today. And I've done evangelism seminars before here. Maybe you've attended one where we filled up the whole time with a lot of good information. That's not what this one's going to be about. We're going to share some content along those lines, but it's going to focus on a dialogue. And one way that we are trying to help make it a dialogue is by providing these sheets in your bulletins. Pull these out if you have one of those in your bulletin. It simply says, the invite challenge a dialogue, and it says, your questions, dot, dot, dot. We invite you to fill in that space. Maybe there's a question or a concern or something specific or someone you want to share with, but you're troubled by something or a challenge that you're experiencing regarding this invite challenge, I encourage you to fill in this space and then take these sheets and put them in the box in the foyer. And what I'm going to do the week before this event occurs, on February 6th, Monday morning, I'm going to take all these sheets of paper and I'm going to put them together, and it's going to form largely the basis for our conversation on that Sunday night. And we're going to have a dialogue. So if you're one who says, I have no troubles at all sharing the gospel, I'm just bold and I'm daring and I do it all the time and it's no problem at all, then this conference or this workshop, this dialogue, it's not for you. In fact, maybe you can come to help teach the dialogue. But if you're like me and you say, I want to share, I really do, because I know it's so important, but I struggle, it's hard, then come to this dialogue. Come and let's talk it through together. But in conclusion, the message that I want to share with you two today is this. By all means, live cautiously when it comes to your savings account, or when it comes to walking down a dark alley, or when you're driving your car in rush hour traffic. By all means, live cautiously. But when it comes to the gospel of Jesus Christ and sharing his love with others, may we live boldly, investing ourselves in gospel ministry and in the lives of others. Let's pray. And Lord, that is our deep desire, to be people who live boldly for the sake of the good news, to be motivated not by a sense of ought, but by the fact that you have transformed our lives, that in you we have found true hope, true life, true love. And we want to share that with those that we care about, those around us. So God, toward that end, we ask for your help. Help us, God, more and more to be faithful in sharing your love, your truth, your gospel with those around us. For the sake of your kingdom and your glory, we pray in Christ's precious name. Amen. Amen. I invite you to stand for the benediction. I do encourage you to see the table out in the foyer. We have a few different sign-ups out there. And I remind you to come back next week and join us for our fifth Sunday fellowship. Deb is at the back. If you want to take one of the baby bottles on your way out, they're in the basket. You can take one and be filling that up. It's good to be in the house of the Lord, to have heard the word of the Lord. Amen. And we conclude this morning with the words that we find at the end of the book of Ephesians. And this is what Paul writes. Peace to the brothers and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with an undying love. Amen. Amen. Amen.